The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by Die Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Berks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robesonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler-Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589. Or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir sauer Großdank zu alle unser Unterstützer.
Gute Maria liebe Kuka und willkommen zum Pennsylvanisch Deichstund, der beste Platz für Deichsuhera auf BCTV. Heute ist der 4. September 2020 und der Sommer ist schier gore vorbei. Es ist schon lang, als ob es Kieler ist, und bis bald kommen die Farbe von Sportjahr Blätter. Es ist auch die Zeit für Ehren, weil die Welschkorn, Kerbse, Ebel, Rumbiere und all die gute Sache Zeit vor. Jahre zurück, September war auch die Zeit für die Arnkarig oder Harvest Home. Von alle die deutsche Bauersleit hen viel gute Sache vom Gorde und Feld nach die Karig mitgebracht, für die Jahreszeit zu feiern und für Orme Nopra zu raushelfen. Vielleicht ein paar von die ländliche Karika, do rum dunne die Arnkarik nok feiern heidesdogs und selis epis für dankbar zu sei für sure. Erstlich heid, habe ich ein paar Nachrichten für die Sportjahrfest an die Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center und Kutztown University. Unser Sportjahr Celebration, Heimatfest, ist virtual gange. This year, Heimatfest is going virtual in cooperation with the German-Pennsylvanian Association, who is celebrating the 15th German-Pennsylvanian Day. And so we are having a combined event for a transatlantic celebration here in the United States, as well as over in Europe. And you can watch presentations on the day of Heimatfest, which is being hosted on our Facebook Live page for the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center. You can celebrate from your own home on September the 26th with a number of online presentations highlighting the music, folklife, art, and foodways of the local culture, including Dave Klein, who will be featuring folk music on the guitar, Broken Spokes for a little bit of Pennsylvania Dutch music with Doug Maidenford and Chris LaRose, a kitchen demonstration from Terry Berger, a folk art demonstration with Rachel Yoder, and a presentation from myself, Patrick Donmoyer, about the history of the Barn Star painter Milton Hill from Virginville, Berks County. We are also proud to highlight this year among us a special presentation from Michael Werner from Oberulm, Germany. He is the founder and editor of the Hiva V. Driva, Pennsylvania Dutch newspaper, and this year he will be talking about his experiences with 25 years of the Hiva V. Driva newspaper, the transatlantic partnership, and also Pennsylvania Dutch music that he has been playing. So we are proud to say this year, Heimatfest is no kam gay. Vielleicht ein wenig unterschiedlich als wie andere Jahre, aber noch am gay for sure. Heimatfest is still going strong, perhaps a little differently than in years past, but still going for sure. Today on the Pennsylvania German Hour, we have something a little bit different for you. I'm hearing from so many of my friends and colleagues that in light of the COVID-19 social distancing restrictions, people are eager to get out of the house and do some driving tours. Friends of mine recently told me they've been driving all throughout the Lehigh Valley, all throughout Berks, taking a look at covered bridges and barns and old churches. Some folks are going to graveyards, many different places where you can see the cultural presence in the landscape. So today I have for you a special presentation about the Pennsylvania Dutch landscape and all the places that you can explore throughout the Dutch country. Today on the Pennsylvania German Hour, I'd like to present the Pennsylvania Dutch landscape, a legacy of belief, identity, and persistence in the new world. Many of us are distinctly aware that as we drive throughout southeastern Pennsylvania, we can see the cultural markers of the presence of many different groups of people who settled this area, but especially in Berks and Lehigh County, you get a chance to see the Pennsylvania Dutch landscape at work. You see active farms, you still see old country churches, and this is true not just in Berks and Lehigh, but also throughout the region. So this is very important that when we take a look at some of these cultural landscape elements, that we recognize the relationships with the local culture, we get a chance to see the way in which people settled this area, the types of ideas that were present when they settled the region, what folks were hoping to achieve when they emigrated to the New World. All of these types of ideas are still present in our landscape today, and they serve as a testament from those who came before us, and there's much for us to learn in the local landscape. Of course, one of the most notable features in our local landscape here in Berks County are the decorated barns. I had begun the process of really taking notice of the cultural presence in the landscape starting around 2006, 2007, when I was driving around photographing historic barns. I got a grant in 2008 to begin the process of systematically documenting all of the barns in Berks County. And many folks are familiar with the results of this work here in Berks. This was an important and exciting time to document historic barns. And initially, when I drove around, I photographed the stars especially, and only later really started to realize and appreciate the way in which the stars were part of broader cultural patterns. You couldn't just separate these barns from the landscape, and you couldn't separate the stars from the barns. All of these different aspects of the local culture are interrelated, and it's very important to remember that even though the stars themselves are, of course, representative of the local cultural presence, we have to see this as part of a broader relationship. Of course, the barns are one of the largest structures in our local landscape, and this is such an important thing to note because of their significance for many of the generations of farmers who are still working in our local communities to put food on the table. This is such an important thing. But for the historic landscape, barns were perhaps even more important. As the largest structures in the landscape, this conveyed something about the significance of the agricultural livelihood here in the region and how important this was for the establishment of the cultural presence in the landscape. If we look close at many of the different buildings in our landscapes, whether we're looking at barns or houses or mills or covered bridges or any types of local structures from the historic landscape, we're going to get a chance to see the way in which these buildings are built from materials that come directly from the landscape itself. Stone and iron coming from the earth. You're going to find the wood was locally sourced. Even for some of the oldest structures, you're especially going to see examples of terracotta, tile roofs. This is something that's rare in Pennsylvania today, but especially in parts of the Ole Valley and the Upper Perkiomen, you can still see the terracotta that was literally taken right out of the ground and fired in local kilns for use with roofing. All of these different elements show a relationship not only between the people, but also the people and the land itself as the process of settlement unfolded. Of course, when folks were first emigrating here to Pennsylvania, this area was historically the hunting grounds and settlements of previous groups of people who occupied these areas, primarily the Delaware, the Lenape, and other indigenous tribes. This area was such an important region. It was largely kept forested because at that point in time, the forest is what sustained the local population, especially with hunting grounds south of the Blue Mountain. As the Pennsylvania Dutch moved into this area, of course, people were displaced. And this is an unfortunate aspect of our local history, but one that we have to be very mindful of as we take a look at the local landscape. We have to recognize that the landscape has not always been the way it is today. It has changed, it has evolved. It shows the cultural marks of every group of people who have ever lived in this area, from the Lenape to the Pennsylvania Dutch, and everyone who followed thereafter. Of course, today, when we drive through some of the back roads of Berks County, we're going to be seeing the Berks County farmscape, usually demarcated by the presence of large family farms surrounded by acreage. While many people, of course, will emphasize the barns or the farmhouses or the other outbuildings, it's important to remember that this cultural landscape is composed of many different facets. of material aspects of the landscape that were built and constructed, as well as those aspects of the landscape that were shaped through generations of use, as well as the natural contours of the landscape. This includes, of course, not only the ponds and streams and rivers cutting through our landscape, the woods and the fields, but also the way in which these areas had designated uses. The lowlands on all of the farms were used as meadows for grazing the cow, many times also for cutting of hay fields early on. Nowadays, we don't cut hay the same way, but at one point in time, the meadows themselves were actually the areas where the hay was cut by hand and brought out of the hay fields in small loads. Today, of course, we're going to be looking at the areas above the farm in this image, the upper fields that are going to be used for hay and for grain crops, for corn, many other different things, as well as the woodlots. This is such an important area as well historically because the wood is part of what was going to also be used for fuel in the home and for many other different processes on the farm. So we can see a comprehensive landscape that developed in this region. And again, it was composed not only of the buildings, but also of the natural contours of the landscape itself. One of the first aspects of the landscape I want to talk about today is the house. This is something that has dramatically changed from previous years of settlement to the present day. And yet many of the earliest homes in our region are still available for us to see. You can see, for instance, some of the examples of the earliest houses that are traced to German-speaking settlers in this region. In the 18th century, especially, examples like the Bertolit log home at the Daniel Boone homestead, just on the edge of the Ole Valley in Berks County, built circa 1740. This is among the oldest of the early log buildings that was first constructed in this area. It's such an important thing to note that many of the settlers that were coming to this region were putting up log homes because this was a simple way to construct a home, to be able to get a provisional dwelling built for a temporary circumstance, as they were later many times going to be upgrading these buildings to more formal farmhouses as they experienced a little bit more success and a little bit more permanence in the landscape. This is such an important thing to remember that many times these log buildings served the use of the family for maybe only a generation or so before being upgraded. And you can see, especially with this style of building, some very distinct features. You can see the central chimney sticking out of the roof. That chimney, of course, showed the dividing line within the lower level of the home. The hearth would have been in the very center of the home as the center of all life. The entrance on the left would, of course, be the entrance into the kitchen. The kitchen would have been the front entrance of the house, showing the way in which the work and daily life on the farm would have been absolutely essential to domestic life. The other areas of the lower level of the house were typically a room heated by a stove called the Stub. And this room would have been a multi-use room where folks would have met and gathered and done work. All kinds of different aspects of life would have happened in that multi-purpose room, as well as a lower level bedroom called the Kammer. And the Kammer would have, of course, been the bed chamber. And this would have been for the husband and wife of the family. Everyone else within the family would have typically slept in the upper story loft, which you'll see has a nicely high-peaked roof to allow for maximum overhead area. The children and even some other generations of the household would have slept in the upstairs area. And you can see the way in which this particular style of dwelling did not lend itself to privacy. This was a dwelling that was meant essentially for upgrading later on. But again, it's a very significant part of our local landscape. And you can see these not only out in the country, but also in many other parts of the local landscape. You can see them in towns, like in Lebanon, Pennsylvania. There is the Chestnut Street Log House from 1769. This is one of the buildings that piqued my interest when I was a child, and I would drive up Chestnut Street. I actually lived on Chestnut Street on the other end of town as a child, and this house always stuck out to me as being very mysterious because it showed an aspect of the Lebanon city that we rarely were able to catch glimpses of in any other part of the city, the earliest establishment of the area known as Lebanon today. Of course, you're also going to find many other types of buildings in the early landscape, and by no means were all of these old buildings log. You're going to find just as many stone buildings being built as part of the first generations of buildings and dwellings, ancillary houses or workhouses on the farms, barns and other aspects of the local landscape were also built out of stone. And some of these, to our eye today, appear unique because of the fact that they combine features that we would not be seeing in many different aspects of the landscape today. A great example of this is the Dietrich Ancillary House, built in 1746. It's part of the Berks Preservation Trust today, and it's situated right in the Ole Valley. You can see a red tile roof, an overhead hooded doorway on the second floor for being able to haul grain sacks into this upper story, which may have served as a granary. There are essentially living quarters on the first floor, as well as a workroom. The lower level could have been used for milk storage or work. Many different aspects of life could have been situated in this particular split level dwelling. You can actually drive a wagon right up to the first floor, but the lower level would have been accessed by the gentle slope of the landscape. This is a unique building. There are many different ancillary buildings in the Ole Valley that show the marks of this early phase of dwelling. Here is a large formal house built in the style of some of the earliest German-speaking settlers in Montgomery County in the Upper Perkiomen Valley. This was the 1736 Henry Antes house. And Antes was a Moravian missionary and schoolmaster. He built this house not only as a dwelling place, but later converted it into a Moravian school. And it was a central part of the local community in Upper Frederick in Montgomery County. Today, it is also the site of the Goshenhoppen Historians, Goshenhoppen Folk Festival. You walk into the front door, you go right into the kitchen where there are demonstrations happening. You can see on the lower level bedrooms and a room with a stove. The upper level would have been used for sleeping quarters, but it is a massive, beautiful building with a high roof line and a central chimney. All of the early features that you're going to be seeing on some of these formal stone houses that were built by some of the first generations of German-speaking people settling the region. Very rapidly, however, in the local region, you're going to find that many of these Pennsylvania Dutch families were immediately going to be embracing other forms of architecture that were part of the broader American experience. This is such an important thing to remember because we often fail to realize the way in which the parts of the early landscape are part of a shared culture. This is what makes America unique, is that we're not going to be looking just at a single monolithic culture settling the landscape, but instead you're going to be seeing the way in which many different ethnic groups who settled throughout the region shared their traditions to produce a unique New World identity. This is one way you can see it in the local landscape in the early Georgian style houses. This is the Sheridan Farmhouse built in 1814 at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University. You can see a classic modest Georgian dwelling here. It is a five bay dwelling where you can see that on either side of the front door, there are two windows flanking either side. It is a fascinating example of an English-style house being built and used by a Pennsylvania Dutch family. There are chimneys on either end of the house because the heating was situated on either side through corner fireplaces in the parlor and then on the other side in the dining room. It is a fascinating way that you can see the way that the English-style architecture was widely adopted throughout the region and was a significant part of the local landscape. Pennsylvania Dutch families were building barns that were reminiscent of some of the European aspects of their culture that they brought along with them, and yet they were embracing houses that were part of the broader English-speaking population in the main line as well as in the greater Philadelphia area. And you'll also see this sometimes creeps into local log architecture as well, where you see the same types of Georgian architecture, like this small high street log house circa 1800 in Gettysburg. You can see that the chimney is on one end of the house. This is what would be typically referred to as a small three bay Georgian house, or in some cases people refer to this as a half Georgian if the two windows are on one side of the door rather than bilaterally symmetrical arrangement. And so this is a fascinating thing to see the way in which this was also a common form for log homes. Originally, this would have had siding, clapboard siding put over top of the logs. Many times today, people open these up in order to be able to see the log structure underneath because folks are fascinated by the way in which this shows the older building techniques, even though many of these early homes would never have revealed the logs because the logs were the structure of the house. They were not meant to be shown. For poorer families who may not have been able to keep up some of the siding on the outside of the house, you would sometimes see the logs peeking out under the porch or other parts of the house. However, usually these were completely sided over or in some cases fully stuccoed and plastered. And here's another example of a stone half Georgian house, the Captain Peter Icky's house in 1760 in Abbottstown, Adams County. This is a fascinating example of a Germanic style log house with a central chimney on the one side and a stone half Georgian addition on the other. Perhaps one of the most notable historic examples of a Pennsylvania Dutch Georgian farmhouse is that of David Hottenstein just outside of Kutztown, Berks County. It is especially well known because it is considered a formal Georgian home. You can see the way in which it has keystone articulations above the windows and formal date stones on either side of the upper central window of the house. These formal date stones from 1783 show the names of both the husband and the wife of the family, which is a notable thing that you find among the Pennsylvania Dutch. Both the male and female parts of the household were equally recognized on the stone facades of many Georgian homes. And you can see the name of David and his wife, Katerina Hottenstein. Similarly, you can also find this on the Johannes Bollman house in the Milbach area, just outside of Schaeferstown, Lebanon County from 1819. You can see Johannes and Anna Maria Bollman on one side of that upper window and their son Jorg on the other side from 1819. He was the inheritor of the home. And so you can see the way in which these early date stones on the outside of the house are going to be showing aspects of the family and the passage of time through the generations. Another example of an early date stone showing the husband and wife's name is the Johann Peter Troxel house from 1756. Has an inspirational German language blessing. It says, Gott behüt dies Haus vor alle Gefahr für unser Seel und des Himmels soll. This is an old standard German blessing with variable spelling compared to standard German today, but it says, God protect this house and all from all calamity and lead our souls into the halls of heaven. You can see these same types of German language blessings and date board inscriptions being used on English houses as well as German style houses throughout the region, and especially on federal homes. From the early 19th century, you're going to find examples of federal ornamentation with Pennsylvania Dutch flair, just like the Knab house that you can see on the left, Abraham Knab and Elizabeth Knab, 1817. You see formal federal elements as well as a whirling flywheel above the front door. You can also see this on a house near Schnecksville in the lower right, again with the same inscription as on the Johann Peter Troxel and Magdalena Troxel house from the Lehigh Valley. And above that, you see the federal eagle from the Valentine Stoll house from 1804 in Kutztown. It says, Gottes Segen macht reich. It means God's blessing makes you rich. Now, I've always had to wonder whether or not a person believed that richness was considered a blessing of God, or whether or not the idea was that the blessings of God are all the richness you need. One could interpret this particular blessing in a number of different ways. You can also see a lot of these homes in the Pennsylvania Dutch cultural region also later adopting high Victorian styles and East Lake styles. This is classic American architecture and one of the important things that you can see all throughout the region. Even outhouses in the Kutztown area sometimes are decorated with the same type of Victorian flair that you would find on formal dwelling places. And I believe that especially among the Pennsylvania Dutch, this level of ornamentation was sometimes used in excess of other areas, taking common vernacular buildings and essentially elevating them above their counterparts in the region. You're going to find, for instance, that a lot of common outhouses are pretty plain, but this particular outhouse has been elevated amongst its peers as an example of a high Victorian outhouse. The next building I want to describe from the local landscape is Die Kerk, the church. This is such an important building in the local landscape and among the first administrative buildings and community buildings built in the local landscape. As soon as German-speaking people were arriving in this area, they were building churches and meeting houses as being some of the most important parts of their local lives. It is where they met. It is where they planned their communities. It is also where they worshiped. And so we can see the earliest churches served a variety of different purposes. One of the oldest of these churches in the local landscape is the Gemeinhaus at Old Goschenhoppen from circa 1730. This particular building is one of the very oldest church buildings. You can see it has two front doors. It has a central chimney slightly offset. That is because on one end of this building, there was a meeting house room and a fireplace where folks would have been able to essentially meet with one another, as well as have a kitchen fireplace on the opposite side of the chimney. So this would have been both a dwelling place for the minister, a dwelling place for the schoolmaster perhaps, as well as a place for the congregation to meet and to worship, as well as to plan their community. This is behind the Old Goschenhoppen Church in Waxhaw in Montgomery County. And this is a fascinating example of the way in which these types of early congregations built their houses of dwelling and their houses of worship, I should say, as dwelling places as well, combining many different functions in a practical sense under one roof. You can see a similar situation at the Byerland Mennonite Meeting House from 1755 in Lancaster County. Only the chimney is just on one end of the building. This is just one large room with a fireplace. You could heat it by the fireplace, and also the congregation could meet. This was a fairly small space, so one would have essentially found maybe as many as a dozen families in there, but probably not much more in 1755. So it had essentially a limited amount of space to accommodate the many functions, but it had multiple doors because likely it would have been harder to get in and out if the families were lined up on church pews in front of that fireplace. This would have been a complicated space to pack with families. So you can see the way in which these types of early buildings reflect the local landscape and the modest community planning that was taking place at that point in time. Within just about one generation or so, you're going to find that many of these local communities were upgrading from their local log churches to more formal brick churches. And many of these were still in the meeting house style. These were often federal buildings. You see the arched windows. You see formal architectural elements. And for some of them, they had steeples. Many of these early ones did not have steeples, and it is notable that they did not have crosses. Now, this is such an interesting thing because when we think of local Christian churches today, we think of big steeples. We think oftentimes of those American cathedrals built in a neo-Gothic style, borrowing elements from the cathedrals of old Europe. These are not the oldest churches in our communities. The earliest country churches were very modest. They were meant to be modest, and they were meant to reflect pietism and the trends in Protestant Christianity at that point in time, embracing simplicity, embracing the notion of equality among the members of the congregation, reducing the notion of the hierarchy between the clergy and the members of the congregation, putting everyone on an equal footing. These particular churches were meant to democratize the space and to create a sense in which the community was the heart and soul of the church, that the church itself was the community and that the building was just the meeting house. So you won't find crosses on the tops of these steeples because for many of these Protestant groups, they thought that was too Roman Catholic and wanted to depart from the hierarchy that was so central to the Roman Catholic Church in Europe. Here's an example of the Binnagel Lutheran Church built in 1815 in Palmyra in Lebanon County. A fascinating example. You'll also see Bellarmine's Union Church built in 1815 in Mooresville, Berks County, another example of a federal building, perhaps one of the most ornate of all of the federal meeting house churches that you'll find that has pilasters as well as dentil moldings. It has return cornices and extremely elaborate fenestration and windows that are going to be showing elaborate glazing patterns. So this is a fascinating thing in Mooresville, Berks County. Inside of these churches, you'll see many times a typical layout with an elevated pulpit that looks somewhat like a chalice. Some people will call this a wine glass pulpit. But the reality was, this was to elevate not the clergy, but to elevate the word that was spoken from the pulpit. You'll find that typically the pulpit was on the north wall, and there were three entryways on the east and west and the south entryways of the church. The congregation typically sat in a horseshoe or semicircular shape on the three walls of the church, and that there was also a wraparound balcony in the upstairs. This is the Old Zion Royers Reformed Church from 1813 in Brickerville in Lancaster County. Here's the interior of the Binnagle Lutheran Church from Palmyra. You can also see an example of this wine glass pulpit and a sounding board above that was meant to echo the or reflect the sound of the minister from preaching. It allowed the reflection of the sound, not just in the lofty arched ceilings of these churches, but also downwards towards the congregation. This particular building also has elaborate paintings behind the pulpit, and you can see many different religious inscriptions in German. You'll also see that a cross has been added, which is a modern addition as well, from the later era of the congregation. In the late 19th century, they also did faux stone on the inside of this particular church. I believe it was done by Imhoff, who was a painter in the Reading area known for doing this kind of work in local churches. Here you can also see an example of Bellamy's Union Church, built in 1815. Again, Mooresville, Berks County, and here's a good example of what you can see from that sounding board above the pulpit. Here's what you would typically see across from the pulpit in many of these early congregations. You can see the church choir. So while the minister may have felt emboldened by being elevated above the congregation, they also were directly in eyesight of the choir that would have been sitting at the eye level of the minister as well as higher. So you can see the way in which this is going to also reflect the local landscape. These types of country churches are visible all throughout the local landscape in Berks and in Lehigh and in Lebanon and in Lancaster. Here's a nice example of the Hill Lutheran Church from 1837, had two entryways. Some of these meeting houses emphasized an entryway for women and for men. This is still done in some plain communities among the Old Order Mennonites. But this is a fascinating thing to see, especially these elements of the way in which the spaces were once used still being seen in the old churches in the local landscape. This particular building also has an elaborate inscription on the front as well. You can see this particular inscription on the front of the church says Berg Kirche, or Hill Church. It says, Wie lieblich sind deine Wohnungen, Herr Zabaoth. How beautiful are thy dwelling places, O Lord of hosts. This is a religious, inspirational inscription. It doesn't have a date of the church. The date is actually on a cornerstone on another portion of the church building. You'll also see many different types of ornate carvings on many of the local churches, including the oldest Lutheran congregation in North America, which is located at the Faulkner's Lutheran Church in the Upper Perkiomen Valley in Montgomery County. It has a rosette right above the door. Some folks think of this as being a symbol of Christ, as being the lily of the valley or the rose of Sharon. Other folks think about them as being the morning star, another reference to Christ imagery in the Bible. Of course, other folks think this may also just simply be an ornament put there by the stonemasons. We will never know for sure, but it certainly is a beautiful addition to the keystone at the very top of the arch of the doorway. You'll also find in some cases references to Christ as being the cornerstone or keystone of the church. So you can find these types of biblical references undergirding this type of symbolism in many different aspects of the scriptures. You'll also find some secular and sacred themes being interwoven in some of the oldest inscriptions on local churches. This particular one says, Heidelberg Township, Berks County. This is a High German Reformed Church, which was built in the year of our Lord, 1766. All those who go in and out should be obedient to God and King. However, at one point in time, a very zealous patriot got up there with a chisel, probably sometime in the middle of the 19th century, and crossed out the word King because they felt as though this inscription, which was done prior to the American Revolution, needed to just be updated. And so in the process, they not only knocked out the word caney, they also knocked out the first syllable of the word gehorsam, which means to be obedient. And you will find that this inscription no longer actually reads to be obedient to God, because the word obedience has actually been truncated. This is on Haynes Church in Wernersville, just outside of Reading. It's interesting to see this type of interplay between the people of the congregation and the inscriptions on their churches, between the German language and later those who maybe couldn't even read the German language, but maintained these inscriptions on the local churches nonetheless. And of course, it's important to remember that for many of these local churches, the church architecture does not stop at the edge of the wall of the building or the eaves of the roof. It continues well out into the acres that surround the church, the cemetery, which is going to show monuments to all of the faithful departed. And of course, these monuments are oftentimes articulated with local imagery, imagery that you will find all throughout Pennsylvania and even in some cases throughout the Mid-Atlantic, showing religious imagery of winged beings, showing angels or the souls of the departed. You're going to find hearts, crowns, flowers, many of which also have biblical imagery and are evidence of the piety of the individuals who were placing these stones for their deceased family members who were thinking about the resurrection and the life hereafter. You'll see images of three flowers coming out of an urn, the idea of the urn being emblematic of the vessel or the temple, the individual body who upon death is going to blossom into the life thereafter. You see three flowers indicating the Holy Trinity. You'll find examples of the heart, a pietist symbol showing the contents of one's soul, the intentions of one's life on earth, the love that they share with their fellow man, as well as the supernal sacred love for all things. You'll also find examples of the crown, which is biblical imagery for the crown of life being given to those who go on to the next life. You'll see images of many different aspects of religious imagery showing up on early tombstones throughout the region. And these are a testament, again, to the piety of local people and the way in which they celebrated the lives of those who passed away. And for many pious Christians, this, of course, was something to celebrate in the sense that a person was then going on to the next phase of life. The churches were also instrumental in founding some of the earliest schoolhouses. So I want to talk about Es Alt Schulhaus. Many times other aspects of the local landscape that you can drive throughout the local region and see. These early schoolhouses many times were actually the very same as the old churches. And so many times you'll find that the meeting house churches were oftentimes used as both a church, a meeting house, a Gemeinhaus that could have housed the minister, as well as potentially a schoolhouse. And we do know that the Byerland meeting house probably served as a schoolroom in addition to a meeting house. But there are many, many examples of these. For instance, the Deep Run Mennonite schoolhouse in Perkasy shows a central chimney where there would have been a stove in this building. And inside, you can also see the rows of desks, as well as the desk in the very front for the teacher. This is how these early schools were set up. It was in conjunction with a church, and you'll find that in many cases, these were supported by the churches. And many times the minister also served as a schoolmaster, or in some cases, an organist or a deacon within the church would have been a person who also served as schoolmaster. In some cases, you'll find that not only was the schoolmaster also say a church organist or a deacon, but they might have also been a carver of stones. We know of several examples of schoolmasters who were also stone carvers who were creating the local tombstones throughout the region. Here's another view of the same interior. So this is what one of the earliest schoolhouses in our region looks like. But you see many different formal examples of 19th century schoolhouses as well. Here's an example of the Franklin Schoolhouse on the National Register of Historic Places in Lower Saucon, rebuilt in 1880. This particular schoolhouse is a nice example of a stone schoolhouse. Many of these early buildings, of course, are going to combine various building techniques, and you're going to see examples of stone as well as brick, especially in the 19th century. And the interiors of these schoolhouses are also going to reflect changes in educational style and the local mandates for the common schools that were established in Pennsylvania as free schools. Some of the earliest free schools were supported by the local churches, but many of the earliest schools in our neighborhoods were actually pay schools. So you had to pay in order to have your child educated. As of the 1830s, many of these schools, of course, were converted to free schools if they weren't already and became common schools. Of course, the heyday of the one-room schools would have been the mid to late 19th century when you start to see the standardization of these schools, such as the Freiberger Schoolhouse, originally the Stein School in Berks County at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center, is one of these very standard brick schoolhouses that you see all throughout Berks County, Lehigh County, and even in parts throughout the Mid-Atlantic, because similar policies governing the way in which these schools were built were adopted all throughout the eastern United States. The interiors oftentimes were structured similarly, with rows of desks, many times the boys on one side, the girls on the other, a stove in the middle or in the back, portraits in the front, especially showing Abraham Lincoln and George Washington. These portraits were so common, especially after the time of the American Civil War. You were going to find these two most popular, celebrated presidents, especially in Northern schools, were celebrated as models of community service, as models of leadership, and their portraits were commonly placed in the fronts of many of these local schools. You'll also find in some cases that these local schools were also Sunday school buildings on Sunday afternoons or Sunday mornings. And such is the case with the one-room schoolhouse at Huff's Church. This today is the church office, but a number of these also incorporate church architecture. You see steeples and sometimes even stained glass or other types of church architectural features. Today, you still see one-room schoolhouses being used throughout Berks County, Pennsylvania, and Lancaster County as well, especially where you find Old Order Mennonite and some Amish communities, where oftentimes their children are being educated in one or two room buildings, oftentimes modeled on the old one room schoolhouses. These are oftentimes modern buildings with modern amenities, and yet at the same time, they'll have a bell or a cupola on the top, or sometimes they've also been adapted from earlier one room schoolhouses in the region, and this is such an important thing to see. Last building I want to talk about today, of course, is one of the largest and most important buildings in the local region that shows evidence of the local agricultural culture and the establishment of the region, and these would be the barns. Today in Berks County and Lehigh County, we celebrate some of these barns as being the pinnacle of local agriculture as well as artistry, because the decorated barns stand out so much in the local landscape as being examples of pride in agriculture and a sense of blending between the traditional arts and practicality on the farm. The earliest barns that you're going to see in the landscape typically fell into three categories. You were going to find examples of the Pennsylvania barn, which comes in two forms. The Schweitzer on the upper left, which has this very distinctive overhanging forebay or straw shed coming off the front of the building. And many times this is frame while the rest of the building is stone, but sometimes they're entirely frame on the upper story. This is a two-level barn that can be accessed by a ramp in the back end. This would have been one of the earliest forms of a Pennsylvania barn, which would have combined both the forebay and the bank of the barn. This is a style of architecture influenced by continental Swiss architectural features and was later adapted as the standard barn, which you can see on the lower level. This is a barn that has a symmetrical roof line, an overhang on one side, a bank on the other, and you'll see that it has a symmetrical form. A little bit different than the Schweitzer barns that are popular, especially in Lancaster and the midsection of Pennsylvania, but found generously throughout the region as well. You'll also find ground barns like the barn above, on the right, that has a slight slope to the landscape leading to a central threshing area in the barn, but there's no formal bank, there is no formal overhang. Instead, you see usually a single story or split level barn that's going to have stables on one story and just lofts for hay on either side of a central drive-through on the barn's very central bay. The earliest of this particular ground barn style was referred to as a Bodumshire or Grunshire. The Bodumshire would have simply meant basement or ground barn. the Grunshire also means ground barn or ground level barn. And so in the very center of this barn, you can see that you can drive right through the barn with a wagon. On either side of that central drive-through of those double doors would be lofts to unload crops or straw or hay storage on either side. The doors on either end would have been stables for the horses and the cows. These were later adapted to expand the dairies. Many times the dairy would have been on one side and had much larger area for the cows because more cows would have been needed to support a farm that would have had a dairy operation. The horses would have been in smaller area on the other side. Draft horses used primarily for grain operations as draft animals all throughout the farm. The central doors would have been slightly offset in this particular combination of a stone and log ground barn, not too far from Quakertown in Montgomery County. Here is the classic Schweitzer barn as well. You can see the way in which this particular Schweitzer has an overhang on one side that makes the roof line asymmetrical. The roof line in this case is asymmetrical with a framed front forebay on one side. You can see that there's also a gentle sloping landscape that makes a bank on the other side. This is a Swiss feature, which is why this is called a Schweitzer barn. Schweitzer in Pennsylvania Dutch means Swiss. So in the past, when they referred to this as a Schweitzer Shire, they were referring to it as a Swiss barn, as a nod to its earliest roots in parts of Switzerland in Europe. The standard barn is another form of Pennsylvania barn that I've already mentioned. You'll notice it has a forebay. In this case, the forebay is formed by a recessed front wall on the lower level, but the upper area is still overhanging the lower area. And many times these are the most decorated of the local barns. This is one from North Whitehall. You can see three flywheels that are in kind of an alternating pattern across the front of the barn. A little cupola on top. This would have been a late 19th century barn. It is frame above the foundation level. And you generally see over time a transition from log to stone to frame throughout this local area. But there are also exceptions to all of this because some of the earliest Schweitzers are also frame. So you're going to see a wide range of different types of architectural forms, but oftentimes barns that are entirely frame above the stone level, especially standard barns that are built that way, are later. They are mid-19th century and beyond. And examples of these are still being built in the present day today. The barn raisings of the past, however, they were large community events. You were going to see that there was typically a timber framer and a small crew of people who were skilled, who knew how to take the frame and raise the frame. And they were, of course, going to be cutting all of the individual notches for putting these frame members together and then raising the individual frames that were going to serve as the structure of the barn in each of the interior bays. And of course, these were community events. Men, women, and children gathered together to help with every aspect of this process. Everything from putting the frame together to serving the food, to helping to hand out the tools. All of these things were done as a large community effort. And it's important to remember that the barn itself was part of a broader sense of community mutual aid. If I helped my neighbors to build their barn, chances are they would lend a hand when I had to have my barn built as well. And so the way in which people worked together to achieve these goals allowed them to achieve a lot more together than they would have been able to do individually. Inside of these barns, you can see these types of subdividing frames referred to as bents in architectural terminology. A bent is the frame that subdivides each room of the barn, typically the central area of the barn. You could drive in with a wagon onto the second story and you could unload crops on either side. The ladders that are built into these bent frames allowed you to be able to climb to the upper parts of the hay stacks that were going to be in either side of the barn. This is before baling technology, when the hay was going to be stored loose. And you had to be able to climb up in there sometimes in order to be able to get access to that upper portion of the hayloft. These types of barns are still being built today. Here's an example of one that was built around 2005 up in Schuylkill County. You can see the way in which a traditional timber frame was put together. If you look very closely though, even modern carpenters who are building barns like this today are using wooden pegs, and you can see them throughout this particular structure. This was built by an Amish team from Lancaster County in Schuylkill County. Here's an example of a 19th century barn, a decorated barn, a classic Berks County, northern Berks County barn with stone to the eave level. Barn stars across the front. You'll see the barns are part of a broader decorative pattern, including a deckled edge along the bottom of the forebay, articulations around all of the doors and windows of the barn, and the stars are placed at the divisions within the barn. Believe it or not, each one of those stars is located directly at the point of intersection with the vent on the inside of the frame. It divides the barn into four rooms on the inside and divides the front of the barn into four distinct areas. You can also see that one of these areas of the barn has a double door area that is to open up to allow for ventilation when you are threshing in the barn. Threshing is a process whereby you remove the grain from the stalks and the chaff of the straw. And this is a very dusty process. You needed ventilation to help carry that dust away and out so you could open the front doors as well as the back doors of the barn. And that way you would keep down the dust during the process. This is the Sheridan Barn in Maxatawny Township, Berks County. It is located on the Kutztown University campus at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center. Here's an example of a Lehigh County barn. You'll see that the stars are a little bit different. Instead of having solid white backgrounds and colorful star patterns with repeating, usually yellow and black star points, you're going to find that many times there are solid white stars with black articulations on red backgrounds on the barn siding in Lehigh and Northampton County. And this is very common throughout the area. You're also going to find nice examples of teardrops incorporated into many different aspects of these barn stars. And this is a classic Lehigh County arrangement. In central Pennsylvania, you're also going to find, especially in places like Adams County, the use of decorative Victorian louvers. This is due to the fact that a lot of these barns, of course, were being built in the mid-19th century, some before that, of course, but many of these barns, as they were embracing the broader American trends of Victorian architecture, you're going to see these decorative louvers being used all over the barns. And they are a very beautiful, distinctive regionalism in central Pennsylvania. Some of these show sunbursts and stars that are reminiscent of southeastern Pennsylvania, but these are also very unique unto themselves. In western PA, you'll see this taken to a whole new level, where the decorative louvers show these intricate lattice cutouts, and stars are also put up on the gable ends of the barns, showing cutouts that are not unlike balusters and articulations found on local Victorian porches and homes in the East Lake tradition. This is a fascinating time period where people were using cutouts and wooden appliques in many different aspects of their homes and barns, and the barns were keeping pace with the domestic architecture. Of course, if you want to take a look at some of our local Berks County barns, there's many different ways to do this. You can just hop in your car and drive around the area. And chances are, if you go through any of the back roads in northern Berks County, eventually you're going to stumble upon some pretty nice decorated barns. But if you really want to find out exactly where these barns are located, my recommendation is to go to the website for PA Americana. You can go to PA Americana Region's Barn Star Art Tour. And this Barn Star Tour is available on the website, where you can actually get driving directions to go all throughout the local region and explore these local barns. This is a fascinating thing to be able to see a wide variety of different barns all in one shot. That way you don't have to just find them for yourself. You can actually follow the directions. You'll start at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University. And from there, head on out through Virginville, through Lenhartsville, out into the area surrounding Albany Township and Kempton and the Hawk Mountain Sanctuary, and see a wide variety of beautiful things all within just about an hour or so's drive. So this is one way to get more bang for your buck. If you want to go take a tour, you can get a free brochure. You can download it on the website and you'll be able to follow this all throughout the region. And I hope you have happy travels. Und es letztes Ding, bevor mir gehne, ist unser Sprichwort von Monat. Our proverb of the month. This month's proverb is an old familiar favorite, especially among those who have sat on town councils or boards of various organizations. The old phrase, nix gsat is ja gemeint, silence is complicit. I first heard this when I served on the board of the Berks County Versammlung a number of years ago when folks were trying to decide a change in a menu item. And when they went to take a vote, things were a little bit quiet. One person piped up and said, "Nix sut is yakum ain't." And I never will forget that particular use of this proverb. However, it's also important to remember that this proverb also says something very, very important socially. It says that when there are things that are going on in this world, for good or for ill, if we are quiet about those things, we are complicit. So it's important to remember that if there is change that we would like to see in this world, it is something that we should speak up about with our friends and our neighbors and our community. Be the voice of change that you wish to see in the world. Veli vagukas elis alis vas mia hende maria, but a pensophonish deichstun do on BCTV. Mia bedanka uns eich vavace, haben guda munit. Tune into Heimatfest on September 26th. Bleib gesund und mach's gut.
The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by die Pennsylvanische Deutsche Versammlung von Berks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. For more information, please call Joyce Hassler at 717-866-3431. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berks Versammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October in Robesonia. For more information, please call Kathy Shellhammer at 610-390-1088. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch culture and language. Contact us at 610-683-1589 or at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir sauer Großdank zu alle unsere Unterstützer.